Hello, and welcome back. So, today I want to look at signal mixers, and in particular, look at the balanced mixer implemented with diodes. Now, this is a very common circuit found in single sideband encoding and decoding, but rather than looking at how it's used for these purposes, today I want to focus on various constructive methods and how the circuit actually works. So, if you're curious, then keep watching. So let's start things off by looking at what a signal mixer is supposed to do. So an ideal signal mixer is a circuit that can take two input signals of different frequencies and create new signals of different frequencies. So normally you'll get the sum of the two frequencies and the difference of the two frequencies. But based on how the mixer circuit is actually built, other than these two components, you'll have a few more. So you will not just get the basic sum and difference, but you'll also get all sorts of other combinations, so various multiples of the signals added together and subtracted. But more importantly, and the thing that we really don't want today, is that you'll get the initial signals also all bundled up together. And depending on what you're using the mixer for, this may not always be a problem. For example, in a super heterodyne type AM receiver, you've got your input radio frequency between 530 and 1600 kilohertz, and then you have your local oscillator going between 985 and 2055 kilohertz, and then your various mixing products all have different frequencies, but the one that you're really interested in, the intermediate frequency, is so far away from everything else that it's very easy to filter out. So in this particular case, it's not that big of a deal if you also have your initial frequencies all bundled up together, because it's very easy to filter out the useful frequency. And this sort of mixer can be built really easily using a single nonlinear element, or in this case, a single diode. So what I got here on the left side is two signals, 100 kilohertz and 110 kilohertz, and I'm just combining them. And then on the right side, I have the exact same circuit, but with the addition of our nonlinear diode. Now, if we look at the signals, what happens in the two cases? So we have our initial signal. Now you see some sort of modulation on it, but with the other signal, we see that the modulation is only on one side, so the signal is no longer symmetrical. And if we view this in an FFT plot, so with our initial signals, we see clearly our 100 kilohertz and 110 kilohertz spikes and a bunch of noise here and there. But after adding the diode, we still get our initial frequencies, but we also get some new spikes. So we clearly see this 10 kilohertz signal, which is the two frequencies subtracted one from the other. And we clearly see some 200 kilohertz spikes, so the two frequencies added together. So this sort of mixer does work, but it's only useful if the signals are far apart and then can be easily separated. If the signals are all bunched up together, so your mixing products and your initial signals are all very close, then it's not that useful. So for example, in the case of AM modulation, when you have quite a low frequency audio and you mix it with quite a high frequency carrier, so 1 megahertz in this case, you will get your audio frequency, which is far away from everything else, so that's not a problem. But then you'll get your carrier and your two sidebands all bundled up together. So the frequency difference between these is extremely small. So in this case, if you really want to extract one of the sidebands, so either the difference or the sum, then it's really useful to not have the carrier there in the middle. So the bigger the difference of frequency between two signals, the easier it is to separate them. So for this particular application, a mixer that is capable of not producing the initial signals is crucial. And this is where the balanced mixer comes into play, because it has this specific property implemented. So what would these signals look like? Well, to get a better idea, let's look at what an AM signal looks like with the carrier and without the carrier. So I prepared here an AM signal made from its components. So you've got your carrier at 100 kilohertz in this case, and then the upper sideband and lower sideband, each spaced 10 kilohertz away from the carrier. So this would be an AM signal modulated with a 10 kilohertz signal. And then on the right side, we have the two sidebands, but with a suppressed carrier. So without the carrier, we just have the upper sideband and the lower sideband with the exact same frequencies as before. So for the first signal, no surprises, we have our carrier inside the signal at 100 kilohertz roughly, and then we have this modulation on top running at almost exactly 10 kilohertz. But now, if we turn our attention to the other signal, we can see that, well, it still looks like an amplitude modulated signal, but the modulation is going on at about 20 kilohertz, so double that of the initial signal. But if we look at this high frequency content, it seems to be at 100 kilohertz, even though there is no 100 kilohertz in here. So just to confirm, we can look at the two signals in an FFT plot, and we can clearly see that for our full carrier signal, we have the carrier there in the middle at exactly 100 kilohertz, but with the other signal, there is no carrier, so we just have the two sidebands. So now if we look into a bit more detail with this suppressed carrier signal, so we can see that the signal seems to be at 100 kilohertz, and we can also see that at the points where the signal is minimum, it also changes phase. So we can see that it's going one way, and then it suddenly changes phase by 180 degrees, and then goes the other way, and then changes again, and so on. So by overlapping the two sidebands, we seem to get a signal that looks like it's at the middle frequency, but it changes phase from time to time. So we need a circuit that can achieve this phenomenon. It sounds more complicated than it actually is. And one of the key components that can be used to achieve this effect is the balanced transformer, which is basically a transformer with a center tap. And what makes this component special when used for this purpose is that if you insert the same signal into both of its inputs, so for example here I'm inserting the exact same signal on both coils, if we run this, so we have the two inputs, exactly the same thing, but if we look at the output, there's nothing. So because the two primary inductors are wound in opposing ways, the two magnetic fields created oppose each other and cancel out. So the only way to get some sort of signal through this transformer is to insert different signals into the two primary windings. If you do that, then the difference from the two signals will pass on, but if you insert identical signals or signals that contain the same components, then the similar things will cancel out. And this brings us to the balanced mixer implemented with two diodes. So what I got here is one version of the circuit. You'll find multiple versions of it being implemented, so with different input and output ports, but this is the basic schematic. So what I have here is the two signals with the basing adding circuit that we've used previously, and then this passes through the two diodes into our balanced transformer. So if we run this thing, we see our two overlapping signals, so the 10 kilohertz and the 100 kilohertz in this case. And now if we look at what passes through the diodes and add another plot plane, so what we can see is that both diodes are conducting because we have a large enough radio frequency signal, but their outer envelope is modulated with our audio frequency signal. And what we can also see is that the two modulations are opposing in phase, so 180 degrees out of phase. Our upper diode is conducting more when our initial signal is positive, and the lower diode is conducting more when the initial signal is more negative. So if we just overlap the two currents, we can clearly see the phase opposition between the two. Now, it's also important to observe that the signals passing through the two diodes, if taken separately, look exactly like our one diode mixer. So if we check the two signals in an FFT, we can see that both these signals contain our initial frequencies, so our 100 kilohertz and our 10 kilohertz. But by using the balanced transformer, these two should cancel out. Whereas the other signals, the mixing products, are out of phase, so those should not be affected. So now if we look at the output of the circuit, well, it looks like a complete mess at the moment, so there's no clear signal in here, but if we look at it using an FFT transformation, we can clearly see this time that our mixing products, so 100 kHz mixed with 10 kHz will yield the 110 and the 90 kHz. So here in the middle, we clearly see the two sidebands and we can barely see our initial 100 kHz signal. So the mixer is achieving the goal of suppressing the initial signals. And well, of course, we have all sorts of other signals appearing, but these again are quite far away in frequency, so they will be easier to filter. Now, this is quite a common circuit, but it does have a few drawbacks. On the one side, you don't have that much separation in between the inputs, and this can be improved if one of the inputs is connected to the output of the transformer, and then you're using it the other way. But you can build a far better circuit by using a double balanced mixer. And one way looks something like this. So we have the two balanced transformers, and we need four diodes placed into a ring. So unlike a rectifying bridge, here all the diodes are going into the same direction. So with the rectifying bridge, a couple of them were in the other way. But anyway. And one of the nice things about this circuit is that any of the ports can be both inputs and outputs. Now, to better understand how the circuit works, let's resort to a good friend of ours, paint. So if we consider that we have a positive signal coming from our high frequency circuit, this signal will pass through the balanced transformer on one side, through diode 2, through the other transformer down to ground, and it will also pass through the other side of the transformer, through diode 4, down to ground. Now, as long as nothing is happening on our left side transformer, then both the orange and the red currents here will be identical. But now if a signal appears on the left side transformer, so a modulating signal, creating a positive voltage, then this voltage will be translated to the secondary side, and the effect of this will be that the current going through diode 4 into a more positive potential will become weaker, and the current going through diode 2 into a more negative potential will become stronger. So we will get an imbalance in our output transformer, hence we will get a signal to the output. So if we quickly check this in the simulator, we have our input signal that will go through the two inductors, and the two currents are opposing in phase, 190 degrees, and they are both modulated with our input signal. So if we look at the voltages present on the two branches of the transformer, we again see the initial frequencies, the modulated ones, and what we get at the output is the difference between these two signals. So with this circuit, we get a very nice, very clean version of what we were trying to get from the beginning. We see our high frequency signal changing phase when it passes through the minimum point, but we also get a bit of noise. So if we just check this using the FFT plot, we clearly see our two mixing products, so 100 kHz mixed with 10 kHz, 110 and 90, and we clearly see a very nice gap where our initial 100 kHz signal should be. Now, of course, the results obtained with this sort of circuit or with any mixer in general will depend on the driving signals, so if you don't get those right, you will get all sorts of problems, and you can also improve the response by adding filters. So usually you'll see all sorts of capacitors added into the circuit, which help with suppressing all sorts of extra frequencies that you don't really need. So this circuit seems to work even better than the one before. And finally, last thing to do is try the circuit out in practice. And for that, what I got here is a double balanced mixer built with two balanced transformers and a four diode ring. And I set it up so that the two side ports are connected directly to the signal generator with these two cables. and then the middle port goes into the second channel of the oscilloscope. And so that we can make some measurements on the input signals, I also added these T-junctions so that we have direct access to the input signal. Today we'll be working with quite low frequency signals, so these should not have an impact on the performance of the circuit. So now, if we run the circuit, if I turn on only one channel of the signal generator, we don't really have anything coming out through the circuit, so the balanced part rejecting the input signal is sort of working. But if we also turn on the second channel of the signal generator, we now have a clear signal appearing. So my signal generator is set up so that one channel has 100 kHz and the other 110. So what we would expect to see here is the two mixing products. On the one side, the sum of the signals, which is 210 kHz. On the other side, the difference of the signals, which is 10 kHz. So we have two ways to check if the circuit is working. On the one side, we can confirm that the large oscillation is 10 kHz using the cursors. But if we zoom in, we can also see that the small oscillation is about 210 kHz. So right now I'm reading 212. But the best way to see exactly what's in the signal is to look at its frequency components using an FFT analysis. So I set my oscilloscope into FFT mode to analyze what is on the second channel. And here we again can see some clear frequency spikes, and we can check these using the cursor function. So we can see that our two largest spikes are the 10 kHz one and the 210. So the circuit is producing our mixing components, but we also see that there's a bunch of other spikes. And the ones that we are in particular interested in are our initial signals. So we can see that here in the middle we have 105 kHz. So the two spikes to the left and to the right are the 100 kHz and the 110 kHz. So these are our initial signals, and these on the sides are our mixing products. So the circuit is working. It's producing some clear spikes at the sums and differences of the input signals, but it also contains our input signals a bit. And just to see exactly what sort of rejection we have between the two signals, we can see that we have about 33 decibels between our 210 kHz spike and the 110 kHz spike. So the circuit is not working as well as it was in the simulator. And the reason for that is that the components in the simulator were perfectly identical. So the balanced transformer was perfectly balanced. Both the input inductors were identical. In my case, well, they're just as good as my coiling technique is. I mean, all the inductors have the same number of turns, but that doesn't mean they have the same inductance. I mean, other than the number of turns, you also care about the length of the inductor, how tightly it's wound, if there's any imperfections in the magnetic core, and another thing that will influence us is how well the diodes are matched. So even though all four diodes are of the same type from the same manufacturer, they're not perfectly identical. And another interesting thing we can see from our measurement is that the two input signals, the 100 and 110 kHz, even though from the signal generator we are starting with the exact same amplitudes, we don't really end up with the exact same signals. So right now I only activated the 110 kHz signal. We see it here in yellow, the input signal at 200 millivolts per division, and we can see our output signal at 10 millivolts per division. It's very small, but it's there. And now if I only run the 100 kHz signal, so the same amplitude coming from the signal generator, but a completely different amplitude passes through the circuit. So we can see that the left side of the circuit is less balanced than the right side. So this balanced mixer and any balanced mixer built with balanced transformers will work just as well as you can build them. So any imperfections in the components, any mismatches, will cause the circuit to work poorly. But the circuit works. It's quite a fun circuit to make, quite easy to build, but it's quite common and it's widely used. So all in all, hope you got some useful information out of this. Leave your thoughts in the comments. Thank you for watching. Make sure to subscribe to be up to date with all my latest videos, and see you next time. Bye bye.